You're listening to the Graham Robbins Podcast, a podcast dedicated to helping today's business leaders grow and scale their businesses. Get ready to learn and grow from not only the trials and tribulations of our guests, but also be inspired by what successes they've doubled down on to continuously improve. Here's your host, Graham Robbins.
Hey, Nira, thanks for coming on the show today. How are you doing?
I'm good. Thank you for having me.
Yeah, it's great. Great to have this time to sit together and chat. So can you do me a favor and just kind of let everyone know what it is that you do?
Okay. So my name is Nira Arora. Yes, that's my real name. That's the number one question that I always get asked. It's not a stage name. I do the morning show on 94.5 Virgin Radio in Vancouver. And I just hit my 19-year anniversary of doing radio. Before that, I've been working in all different forms of media, whether it was print, magazine print, newspaper print, producing, assistant producing, being everyone's little be behind the scenes, production assistant work. And yeah, so in the media scene now, I've been there approximately, am I going to totally age myself? Yes, about 24 years. And I'm a mom of three beautiful children. I have two boys and a girl. And I have been married for almost 20 years to my university sweetheart, Gary. And I'm a Nanaimo girl, which means I was born in Vancouver. But 1 week later, I headed off to Vancouver Island. And I grew up there until I came to the Lower Mainland to go to SFU. And I haven't looked back since. And I think I've been here longer now than I was on the island. So I don't know if that now classifies me as a Lower Mainland girl, but I still have those island roots that I'll never get rid of. And my parents are immigrants who came to Canada in the 70s. They're from India. So I'm first generation Indian Canadian and super proud, even more so in the last couple of years, of my roots and my heritage and my culture. And that's kind of me in a nutshell. I mean, I could mention things like I love red wine and I'm obsessed with vampires and self-help books, but I mean, I'm sure we'll get into all that.
Wow. Vampires and self-help books. That's interesting.
Yeah. Yeah. It's quite the combo, I tell you.
Excellent. Well, thanks so much. You know, that's a great introduction. And something, you know, that I love to ask is, you know, do you remember your first time on radio? Like, was it live? Was it, what was that experience like?
Oh, I totally remember my first time. It was March 25th, 2002. I remember coming into the building of this little station that could. It was called the Beat 94.5. It was this independent little station. And I was feeling a little bit defeated because at that time I was working for a local television station and doing so much grunt work behind the scenes, just waiting for an opportunity. And it just really wasn't working for me. The stars just weren't aligning. And then my younger brother was like, hey, have you heard of this little radio station that just started? It sounds so cool. And I sent in my resume and I got a call back, and they were at that time, like, they were honest. They're like, you know, what really intrigues us about you was your name. You sound something different. We can't tell exactly what your ethnicity is. And that's kind of what we want to do. We want to be a really diverse station that really encompasses what all of Vancouver stands for, which is diversity. And so they're like, you want to audition? And I was like, sure. And at that time, believe it or not, do you remember DJ Alibaba? Remember DJ Alibaba?
Absolutely. Yeah,
so
absolutely.
DJ Alibaba was the afternoon host. And I remember seeing him in person. And I got so nervous. I had butterflies in my stomach because I used to follow DJ Alibaba around the Lower Mainland when I first came here, because he had the best nights for hip hop and R&B. Mm-hmm. If you were in love with hip hop and R&B and wanted to go dancing in the club like I did. And he was the on-air afternoon jock, and I was auditioning to be the traffic and entertainment and news person. So they threw me on there, and I remember it was kind of sort of up to him of how our energy flowed and if we had chemistry. And he from day one, like from that first moment, he said he knew I was the one, because he asked me how I was doing. And I was like, I'm doing great. How are you doing? And I guess he just right away is like, the flow was there. And oh my gosh, I felt like I was going to throw up being on live radio. But yeah, March 25th, 2002.
Wow. And that's, you know, were you given a script, or was it just kind of go in and just be ad hoc? Was it just off the top, or how did that work?
Yeah, they were like, go in and figure it out, because wow. I had a background in media. At that point, I had been a host, reporter, producer on a multicultural station for three different shows at that time. And I had lots of production assistant work with television behind the scenes. Radio, first time going on live like that. But yeah, I understood the meaning of putting together traffic reports, putting together little news segments, entertainment segments, because I used to help write that for other people and other hosts and put together scripts. So they were like, okay, well, you shouldn't really need training in this, so let's see what you got.
Wow. Mm-hmm. And you know, you've mentioned your name a couple of times at the very beginning. You mentioned, yes, that's my real name. You get asked that a lot. And then back then they also said they liked your name. It sounded different. You know, has that had any sort of impact on, you know, the rest of your life, like naming your kids or anything like that? Have you thought about that?
It's really interesting because Nira Arora, that's my first name. That's my last name. I have no middle name. And that was always interesting for a lot of people. They're like, well, what's your middle name? I'm like, I don't have one. Or a lot of people would think that the last name is made up because it's, you know, lucky. I'm very fortunate with my name. It's a cool name and it sounds really pretty too. And the fascinating part about my name and how I feel with my children and what I wanted to kind of do with my name, growing up, I grew up on the island in Nanaimo and there weren't a lot of people of ethnicity there. And I couldn't stand my name when I was little. I used to come home complaining every single day to my parents. Why'd you give me such a strange name? Why couldn't I just be Nancy? teachers can't say my name. Substitute teachers can't say my name. Everyone makes fun of my name. And I remember my dad saying, like, one day you're going to thank me for your name. One day. And I was like, yeah, as if. But you know what? It slowly started to happen. And when it came to naming my kids, I wanted to make sure that it was something that still was somehow linked to my culture and my heritage, my Indian roots, but still something that isn't so complicated that they'll have to constantly explain how to say their name. So my youngest, I'll start with my oldest. My oldest, his name is Shay. And I was in love with the name Akshay, which is a very popular Indian name. Okay. But my husband didn't like the K in it. So we took out the Uk and just left him as Shay. And then my next son is Avi. Another name that I loved is Avek. And again, my husband's like, oh, don't like the K, get rid of the K. So we took off the K and he
became, damn, Gary. Yeah.
Then he became Avi. And then Jaya, I was in love with this Bollywood actress when I was like a little girl. Her name was Jaya Bhadri, and she ended up marrying this huge Bollywood star that I was in love with. And so there was just a connection there. I always loved the name Jaya. And when I first met my husband and we became friends, I remember him also being obsessed with the name Jaya. And he just met this beautiful girl in Edmonton and her name was Jaya. And I remember saying to my husband at that time, because we were just friends, saying, oh, don't like it too much because I'm going to name my daughter that one day. And he's like, how do you know I'm not going to name my daughter that one day? And then, you know, it just made sense to name our youngest Jaya. So yeah, they all kind of have names that are Indian, but yet I feel slightly easy enough to kind of say for anyone around the world.
And, you know, I don't know why I'm kind of obsessed with names. I think because my name, Graham, I never think of Nira as a name that you would make fun of if I go back to his childhood, right? Like, Graham, I got Graham Cracker and Gray Ham, all this stuff and sort of dealt with that. It was also my dad's name. So that was confusing. But the other thing I just noticed, because I wrote your name down, is your last name's a palindrome.
Yes.
It's the same forward and backwards.
Yeah. Super cool, right?
I never noticed that until I just wrote it down.
Yeah. And a lot of people think, I mean, naturally, Arora, that there would be a U in there, A-U-R-O-R-A. But the Indian version of the last name, Arora, is just A-R-O-R-A. Like you said, spelled the same forwards and backwards.
Wow. That's interesting. Mm-hmm. And so 19 years on the radio. Now, before we met, we've only known each other for what? Is it three? No.
Five.
5 years. Mm-hmm. It's one of those weird things I've always wanted to ask somebody because I've run into, you know, celebrities or actors and things like that. And there's this thing because you're very open on the radio. So people know a lot about you and Gary and because you share a lot. And I've always wanted to ask, like, what's it like when, you know, somebody probably walks up to you and recognizes you, knows your husband's name, knows everything about you. And then it's like, this person is just like Sheila, you know, mm-hmm. she's like a stranger to you and she's like, Nira, and they must relate to you like really quickly. Mm-hmm. You know, what is that kind of like to adjust to?
It was so trippy at the beginning because you would forget sometimes, right? Because you're in your element at work and you understand what you're doing. You understand the stories that you're telling. And it's kind of like, you know, when you see someone out of context, sometimes you can't recognize them right away, right? Like, you know, if you see your boss at the beach and they're wearing like, you know, surfing shorts and you're like, sorry, do I know you? And you're like, oh, right, you're my boss. Okay.
Yeah.
So that was kind of the beginning where I would be, I'm out of my element of being on the show. So then if I was, you know, back in the day before the pandemic, if I'm just out at the PNE or if I was out like, you know, at a concert and if someone would be like, oh my gosh. And then you said this, and then it was about this and how so-and-so and oh my gosh, is that Gary? And you're like, I'm sorry, do I, like, you're trying to figure out what context you know the person.
Mm-hmm.
And then you realize, oh, wait a second, they're a listener. So at the beginning it was a real trip, and now I have so much of an understanding of what the journey, hopefully crossing my fingers and, you know, being thankful that they've been on this journey with me for these 19 years, and that's why they know so much. So my sense of appreciation and gratitude and love for the fact of them knowing the stories and reminding me of these stories, it's awesome. It's so sweet and it's so cool. And especially now, a lot of them even say like, well, my kids listen, or my kids were telling me. So they began that journey, whether they were just ending university and then getting married and now having children and then telling me little stories like, well, I was pregnant when you were pregnant with Shay. And now
oh, wow.
I'm like, things like that. And they have those same associations of the feelings. And I don't know. I feel so lucky that people do want to come up and even share the fact that they listen, because the world has changed so much.
Right. You know? And you've really actually grown up on radio. Like, mm-hmm. How long have you and Gary been married?
So I think, so 2003 we got married. So are we hitting 18 years this summer?
Yeah, you're coming up on it. So you, when you first started radio, you weren't married, had no kids.
Yeah.
And that whole journey you've taken with your listeners through the last two decades, basically.
Yeah. Yeah. It's a real trip. It's super cool. And it's like I said, I'm very, very, very fortunate. And I'm thankful every day that I'm going to work and my swipe card works to let me into the building.
Yeah.
A wonderful day.
Yeah, that's great. And that's another thing I wanted to ask you is, every day you have to come up with something new, like to talk about that's interesting. And your show is how long?
So it's 5:30 a.m. to 9 a.m.
So is that right? 3.5 hours of talking?
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, there's commercials and breaks and things like that. But, and how does that whole production side work? Like, how do you come up with things to talk about and then get 3 hours out of that? I know it can change from, you know, current events and things like that, but how do you deal with that scripting and figuring out what to talk about today?
So for me, what works the best is anything that kind of makes me think twice, or anything that makes me kind of go, So we also play top 40 music. So we're lucky that way. So it's not a full 3 hours of talking, 3.5 hours, but if we needed to, I'm pretty sure we can make that happen. Like, one of the problems that we even had this morning. So the show that I do now is with Johnny, Holly, and Nira. That's the name of our show on Virgin Radio. And even this morning I was saying, oh my gosh, I have so many breaks. We didn't have enough time in the show for all the stuff that we had to talk about. And we always say that's a good problem. That's a good problem when you have so many things. And for me, what works and what happens is I take the smallest life experiences and they become show prep for me. And I'm my friends who know me really well constantly know, like, if we're talking, they'll sometimes be like, oh, wait a second, is this going to make it on your show? And I'm always like, maybe, probably, but I will never reveal my sources and I always use fake names. But anything, everything, like, for example, like, I had to take my kids to a specialist appointment the other day. And, you know, I'm a major germaphobe. Pre-pandemic, I've always been a germaphobe. And I had to use the restroom because the appointment's in Vancouver. I had to drive all the way back to South Surrey. And there was no purse hook in the bathroom.
Okay.
And we talked about that because I am not the only woman in the world that would have been annoyed in that situation, right? Like, you walk into a bathroom and you're like, what the hell? Now I have to cradle my purse like a baby while I have to. Like, little something like that was show prep, right? It's just, you figure out creative ways of taking something that's happening in your life or something that you watch or something that you overhear or something that you see and think, would somebody else relate to that? And how do I turn this into my story or a story that someone else will enjoy listening to?
Yeah. It's funny you mentioned that, the purse thing. And I was at a restaurant once and with Suzanne, and they pulled up a little like ottoman You know, mm-hmm. they saw that she had a purse, and a lot of people put it, you put it over your chair or whatever, falls on the floor when you stand up or whatever. And it's, there's these little things that, that you don't think about a lot as probably a male, but you look and go, oh, that was really observant of them. And that's something that a female usually has to deal with more than a man, I suppose.
Oh, for sure. And it got into such funny little stories of, you know, the people on the show where people called in and gave tips on what to do next time, or, you know, because the other thing I would have done is I would have taken the paper towel, put some paper towel on the floor, and then laid my purse on there. But there was no paper towels. It was only a hand dryer situation. You know, so.
Okay. So any bathroom designers out there, just put a hook somewhere in the facility, right? On the door somewhere.
Obviously. Yes. But that's how we kind of come up with little ideas. And I, luckily my brain doesn't, I mean, it's not a good thing all the time. My brain doesn't really know how to shut off. So it's constantly thinking of ideas for the show, or how I can relate to something for the show, or bring up stories for the show.
And so how does that affect your personality after hours? You know, do you need time to shut down and not talk? Like, do you just want to be silent? And I guess one of the things I think about is, like, you must hide conversations sometimes. Go, I'm going to wait until have that conversation until tomorrow. Like, do you ever have that happen?
Oh, for sure. And it's really hard for my husband, Gary, too, because I'll tell personal stories about us all the time that he may not be ready for. So he'll get people saying stuff to him and he's like, huh, what? How do you know that? Because I'll bring it up on the show. And, you know, so that I have to learn my boundaries with that as well. But he's been such an amazing player and just a teammate when it comes to that, and knows it's for the show. So I've been very lucky with the partner that I have in the business, because not everybody is as fortunate.
Yeah.
Like little things, like I will say, like, you know, I can't go through drive-throughs with my husband because he gets so stressed out. He's embarrassed by us in the car because he thinks we're just a gong show. So
27, you know, small nuggets or whatever.
Yeah. Or like, and hold the tomato, but extra lettuce, and put the pickles on the side. But I do want the bacon, but I don't want it on the burger. So he's like, he finds us so embarrassing. And so, you know, like things like that, I'll just bring up on the show. But the thing that I've noticed about myself recently in the last few years is how much more of a observer that I've started to become in situations, as opposed to the person who's constantly talking or keeping the conversation going or escalating. I've taken on some of those characteristics from my husband, even, because he's a great observer. He loves observing conversations. So I started doing that because he was like, you should really try to observe more. You'll really get some good meat and some good juice. And it's so true. The more you start to observe and watch and listen, there's such amazingness out there that you're like, oh my gosh, that's such great show prep. And so that's been kind of cool. But I definitely, during the pandemic with all this, I've been suffering from a loneliness, as opposed to I'm not feeling lonely. I'm not getting enough alone time. And that's because we're spending a lot of time together at home. Mm-hmm. And that part has been hard because of my job. I feel like I am one of those people that really does need some time by myself alone in the quiet to just kind of reset, regroup, and kind of figure myself out sometimes.
Yeah. And I wondered, so do you think that you need that recharge after talking for, you know, 3.5 hours straight, basically? Do you have a time, or is that part of your commute that you can wind down? Or do you, because the reason I bring that up is because I remember I was on SkyTrain once, and there was a lady that was standing there, and she wanted to talk to people around her, to strangers. Yeah. And she was sort of mad at people for not talking to them. And I said to her, I don't know if I should have said this or not, I said, you know, for all you know, this person works at a call center and they talk from 8 a.m. to 4:30 p.m. And this is their only moment of silence and not talking. Mm-hmm. And so they're really enjoying this moment. And then she wanted to talk. So I was kind of curious, do you have those moments where I need a not talking time?
Yeah, oh, for sure. But I'm not allowed to have them.
you need it, but you're not allowed to.
Yeah. And I understand that's my role. That's kind of what I got into. Right. So if I'm really not in the mood and I don't want to be recognized and I'm just like, just need to quickly run out for some milk. And I feel like I look like crap and I'm just not in the mood. But if that person at the store, if they recognize me, I am going to show my appreciation and show my love for the fact that they recognize me, because the last thing I want on the planet is someone not to like, I want people to listen to this show. I want people to enjoy this show, and I want them to feel good about listening to the show. And why would I ever, ever, ever not want someone to feel good if they try to approach me? Because it's not easy to approach people anymore, right? But I know that I need to turn it around, and I need to switch it around, even if I'm not in the mood to do so. But it's just my way of being honest to say, yeah, like, I do need that downtime. And it took a lot of self-work to realize that it's okay to need that downtime. And when I first started the show, especially, it was really hard because of the hours and just maybe just learning how to work in that type of a team, that type of an environment, and with that many people. And I remember on the weekends, like, my husband was ready to go and let's go out, let's be social. And especially at the beginning, I did not want to, because a lot of my life was so go, 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 and very interactive, that by the time the weekends came around, I just wanted to just veg and stay at home and not do anything except for, like, snuggle up and watch movies and order in. Whereas he wanted to go out and socialize, because that's where he got his social stuff out, not during the weekdays at work, you know?
Yeah. And I guess I'm really intrigued by this, because I think about your relationship with, I'm thinking a lot about the downtime and sort of the recharging time, but your discussions, I guess, they're not really one way. I would think that if you're a solo jockey on the radio talking one way, you never really hear back unless someone's calling in or something like that. But with your crew, you're really talking to each other.
Constantly talking to each other.
Yeah. Yeah. Constantly. So that's what I was thinking, is like, okay, so you're hearing it back, because I would think that once you get home, like, I'd probably want to lock myself in a room for an hour or something just to decompress. And I guess you get a bit of that because your show is early. So you get a bit of quiet time.
Yeah. Like, I actually enjoy my drive, because it kind of preps me, that 35 minutes in the morning around, you know, 4-ish in the morning, it preps me for what's about to happen. Right. So I kind of listen to my, like, Indian mantra music, and I kind of get myself into a zone just to be ready, because even though you're talking to these, to your coworkers, these people are your coworkers, and they're your friends, and they're your confidants, and they're kind of like family. But what happens with family, you have off days.
Yeah.
So if someone's having an off day or having off energy, and or it could be you, like, I feel very guilty when I have bad energy, and I really have to do the work to turn it around. And that in itself is then work. I can't just be like, I can't get into work and just be like, today I'm going to have a shut my door kind of day, you know, like, or I'm not going to really, like, socialize in the kitchen at lunchtime today. No, like, I have to talk, even if I don't want to talk, or if the person that I'm working with is not in the mood to talk. They also are in that position where they know they have to talk, and we have to really balance each other's energies out. And that in itself is so much work.
Right. And do you have any, you know, you talk about sort of self-improvement and things like that. What do you do? Like, so what is your sort of outside of work? And if you want to recharge, and what's your kind of go-to for getting, you know, keeping your energy up? And because you got a busy young family,
and
that takes a lot. And so what, you know, what is it like, or do you have a breakout session that you do on for yourself?
Well, you know, just before the pandemic, I was in a really good routine of working out and exercising, because that's not how I grew up. I grew up playing sports. Like, that's how I used to get my energy out. Everything was about playing sports. I wasn't an amazing sports player or anything, but I played all sports and I loved running and all that kind of stuff. And then the sports thing kind of ended when I kind of started getting into a career. It's like, I don't know, how do I also play sports? It was a little bit difficult. So I then started working out and learning about working out. It's not my thing. So I needed someone to push me. So either I was going to a class or I was in some kind of a fitness program. And then that's been really hard since the pandemic, because I haven't really done that. And it wasn't like I didn't work out to lose weight. For me, it was just to be stronger. I knew I needed it mentally, and I knew I just wanted my body to feel strong. So that was why I did it. And yeah. So now this year, I've been really kind of trying to figure out what my thing is. At that time, it was a lot like that. I love going to counseling and therapy. That was a really big thing for me, talking to someone. That was big. And over Zoom, it just doesn't feel the same anymore.
Yeah.
So I have been struggling this last year. It's been a little bit hard to try and figure out what my outlet is. But I did get into a little bit of gardening last year. Like, that was really strange and weird for me, but it was really nice. It was really relaxing, actually.
Oh, nice. And did you do that in silence, or do you put music on?
Music. Yeah. I love music, and I love my, like, because I'm top 40. So I love my top 40 music, but for me, that is that's my work. And my kids are into a lot of that too. So I get a lot of that. So for me, it's like my old school music, things I grew up to, even things that you don't really get to hear anymore, like Metallica, Nirvana, Guns N' Roses, Red Hot Chili Peppers. And then mixing in some of that Mary J. Blige, you know what I mean? The good old days of good memories for me.
Yeah.
You know?
That's great. So speaking of, radio, and I'm really fascinated by the massive change. So in 20 years that you've been around radio, I mean, satellite radio didn't exist, and, podcasts and Twitter and Clubhouse. And I'm really curious on your take on that. Like what's happening around you is pretty major. And I'm just kind of curious what you see happening there with radio versus these other platforms.
Well, it is really interesting. And that's why I say, I'm always super grateful for every single day that I get to go into work. Because, platforms are constantly changing, but I've constantly kept up on a lot of the research that goes along with this. And people still always come back to radio. If it was a pie, you're looking at a pie, right? And you start hearing all these, oh my gosh, Spotify is so big. Oh my gosh, podcasts are big. Oh my gosh, look at Siri. You do. But when you still look at the pie and you see the slices are still very thin for what the other choices are for everyone. And the biggest chunk is still going to radio. And especially since the pandemic, more and more people actually have been coming to radio because it's kind of like a friendship that you start to build with people and they start to miss you. And it's great that you get to make your own playlist for a while, but for how long? And will you start to get a little bit bored? You might. And then at least, with our show, we want to make people feel like they're learning something. We want to make sure people feel like, oh, hey, did you hear that on the show this morning? We want to make sure we make them feel good. We make them laugh because they're long for the ride with us. And hopefully that brings something to them right now that may be missing in some form of a connection. And that is exactly why people are still coming back to especially morning show radio, because they feel like they're hanging out with a group of friends, hopefully, if you're doing your job right,
Yeah. And, you just made me realize something that I guess is obvious, but I hadn't really considered, is that, your show is very local in a way, right? Mm-hmm. It could be a national show, but I mean, you're talking about things in your city. Mm-hmm. So super relatable to people in the area, where if I'm listening to, whether it's a podcast, it's somebody in New York or Texas or whatever, and I don't really know what's going on there, but that's something I hadn't really considered as a draw, is that they're talking about your town. You're talking about our town. You're talking about experiences that I've been to that nightclub, or I've been to that gym or whatever.
Well, think about it. As soon as I said DJ Alibaba to you, the nostalgia that people automatically probably even feel going, oh my gosh, I used to go to Foo Bar at Cheers on Thursday nights, even though I lived in Coquitlam, we would travel all the way out there because that was me. I was going to SFU. I travel. I didn't even know what Surrey was, but I would draw. I don't know how I'd get there, but I'd get there. I had no idea where I was in the Lower Mainland. I had no clue, but I knew I partied like a rock star.
Yeah.
And then I would go back to, right by SFU, it's real life stories, and hopefully you're saying them in a way that makes people understand that they are invited to go on this story time journey with you and they're a part of it,
Yeah, no, that's fantastic. Another topic that I really am interested in as a, a father of I've got daughters and a lot of big important females in my life is this whole sort of discussion around sort of female versus male. I don't mean versus, I mean the one thing I see on sort of LinkedIn a lot recently is, I'm not a female CEO, or I'm not a female broadcaster. I'm a broadcaster. I'm a CEO. And I find this very fascinating, and I want to learn about it. And one of the things I was thinking about is, as soon as I hear that you're working these hours, you're commuting back and forth into Vancouver, you have a young family, my first thought, and I'm just being honest, is wow, you've got a lot to balance. Mm-hmm. And then I heard this the other day where somebody said, you never say that to the husband.
No.
You know, and I'm kind of curious, like, I don't go, oh, Gary, man, you're balancing this young family and working. I don't, you know, that's kind of old school sort of traditional thinking. And I'm wondering what your take is on that. Like, how do you think about women in the workforce, women, you know, balancing it all and having this sort of dominant sort of relationship between male and female in family and in business? Like, that's a big wide-ranging opening, I know, but I'm just very fascinated by it. And I'm just kind of wondering what your take is on, you know, the female versus male roles, I guess.
Yeah. I mean, for me, it's, there's always been like this major drive inside of me from the very beginning of time. And like, I mean, like I said, I think I've done lots of therapy to figure out where that comes from or where that stems from. So for me, I don't know if that in itself was the female versus male thing. But what I did realize that having that drive inside of a female body was very difficult because there was so many obstacles along the way. And regardless of whatever situation, anything that I was in, I mean, I started working at the age of 13 at Wendy's, right? Like, I, no matter what job I have been in, there has always been a glass ceiling for women. And I feel that I can say this, that I have helped pave the way for other females who want to get into broadcasting, and I've made the road possibly a little bit smoother. When it comes to balancing everything, it's ridiculously hard. And there are days when I'm like, oh my gosh, I don't know how I'm doing it, but you figure it out, you make it happen. And someone did ask me when I had my third, she's now 3 years old, it's a girl. Mm-hmm. And they asked me, like, how much longer do you want to work? And I said, no, I look at
See,
it.
That's exactly my point, yeah. Is they would never say that to Gary, right?
No,
And so I love this conversation. I think it's so fascinating.
And it was really interesting, my answer to her. And I didn't even realize, I don't know why that they came out the way it did. And I said, I want to work until my daughter, my youngest, Jaya, is old enough to understand that her mom was a career mom.
Hmm.
And I don't know why that's so important to me, but it is. I need her to have an understanding because my boys do. My boys have a major understanding of the fact that I'm a career mom and, you know, I'm trying to do it all. I'm not saying that that is the answer because you can't always be able to do it all. I'm trying to do it all. But they know, and they've been a part of that whole, you know, with how important of a role their father plays in their upbringing for the times that I'm not there in the mornings, right? Like, mornings is the hugest, one of the hugest times of the day.
Yeah.
And my husband has been in charge of that since my kids were born. And I really need my daughter to have an understanding of, I don't know, seeing it, putting it all together before I'm ready to call it quits.
Yeah. And you just made me think of something like seeing, like Jaya seeing her father too be super responsible, you know, whether it's breakfast and getting them dressed and getting them out the door and dropping them off and things like that. I'm curious about your thoughts on, I don't even know what the wording is. Like, do you consider yourself a female radio host or are you just a radio host? Like, I think this is one of the conversations that happens so often is, you know, do you want to be looked at as on par, or are you proud to be a female? And maybe, and one question I haven't asked you is, like, percentage wise, is it a lot of females on the radio versus men, or, you know, is there kind of a known mix on mm-hmm. that?
Yeah, there's a lot of female broadcasters, which is amazing. We actually, I think, dominate in radio right now, which is fabulous. Do we dominate in terms of money? I don't know. I think that one is still kind of questionable. Do we dominate in terms of management positions? I'm not sure. Do we dominate in terms of speakers when we were going to conferences and seminars? I don't know. But I don't mind being known as a female broadcaster. I'm actually very proud of the fact that I'm a female broadcaster. But I remember in another career, do you remember when it was actors versus actresses? And all of a sudden it came out
yes.
and females came out and said, don't call us actresses. We are also actors. And now I'm, because I talk about entertainment because I do the biz every morning, which is like all about Hollywood and what's going on in Hollywood land and music. And I now also try not to say actress. She's an actress. I'll say she's an actor because it came out straight up. It was a big article about it, how no longer do we want to be called actresses. We want to also be known as actors. It's not just a male thing. That's just what people are. They're actors.
Yeah. And I think there's the same thing in restaurants. Is it's not waiters or waitress, it's a server.
It's a server, yeah.
And what is it? What was
stewardesses,
it for?
Stewardesses, flight attendants.
Yeah, flight attendants, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. So there's that change. I mean, I think, you know, for me, I think it's a very complicated discussion to have because I still have this traditional cultural side of me where I believe in some forms of roles. And I'm not saying that to be a bad thing. I just believe that there's female energy and there's male energy. And I'm attracted to male energy. And if in my relationship, I start taking on too much of the roles in every single situation, I'm then going to be depleting my husband of the male energy. And if I deplete him of his male energy, then I'm actually doing myself a disservice because I'm the one who's attracted to his male energy. And for him, vice versa as well. Like he's also attracted to my female energy. I'm not saying this is all relationships. I'm talking about just mine and my husband. Mm-hmm. He's attracted to my female energy. And if I start going overboard with my male energy, like that's causing a misalignment of our energies, right?
Yeah.
And there are little things. Like I can open the pickle jar. I can. You know, but I think for me, it's still cute for me to walk up to my husband who's sitting on the couch. And because if I made myself a tuna sandwich, can you open this jar for me? Like, even though he's rolling his eyes, like he's understanding, we make fun of it. I'm like, there's certain things, the light bulb needs to be changed. You know, like my husband Gary will say, the ladder is right there. Like you're holding the light bulb, just change it. I'm like, no, that's your goal. Yeah. And some people will not agree with what I'm saying. And that is totally fine because I'm not saying I'm right. I'm just saying what works for me. I still want to keep some of my female energy in some situations because it does start to get a little bit complicated because women are taking on more and more and more and more and more, and men are getting more and more confused about how we want to be treated.
Yeah, that's funny. Kevin Hart does this great joke about, I probably shouldn't say the details, but he does this great joke about, you know, his wife finding, you know, X-rated stuff on his computer or something. And then he went onto her computer and all she had up was like guys hanging pictures on, you know, and hanging shelves. And like that turns her on is like people were doing stuff around the house, right?
Yes.
And it's funny because the reason I'm really curious about this is because, you know, my business is about 80% women. And what I've really realized is every person is different. Every person, like you said, you're proud to be a female broadcaster, but some people would say, take that out. So I've had scenarios where I'm in this business group and we want to make sure we have great female members in our organization. And so there becomes this push for female members. Okay, we got to get more females in the group. And then some of the females are like, well, why don't we just be looking for good people? Who cares if they're male or female? But then other people are like, absolutely. Let's get more females. We need to do this. And so what I'm really trying to learn is there a mix or is it just more about asking what the person would prefer? You know, do you want to be called out as, you know,
I don't mind because, you know, there's still categories, right? Like there's still categories for so many different things. And I don't think if someone wants to call me a broadcaster, I'm fine with that. If someone says, you know, she's one of the longest running female broadcasters in the Lower Mainland, I have no problem with that either. It's not offensive to me. It's still just a sign of the times. And will that change for the future? Probably. And maybe did I have something to do with that? Hopefully. My concern is more about just how like women get pinned against each other at the workplace. And that is my main issue when it comes to like females and the workplace and how we have to constantly remind each other that we're on the same team. But the thing that I feel it gets complicated is if you do have an issue with someone at work and they happen to be female and you're a female, if you want to say something about it, other people will automatically turn it into, well, of course, because women just have to be like that.
Oh, you know, interesting.
That's where I find it frustrating. Whereas can't it just be one professional to another professional? And hey, like if something didn't, like say the report wasn't filed properly. Say I was the one, okay, I didn't file a report properly and I'm a female and another female supervisor needs to talk to me about it. Am I going to be like, oh, hush you, you're just after me because I'm a girl and you're a girl? No, that's where my issues lie in the workplace when it comes to females. And that's what I really want to abolish as opposed to being calling a female broadcaster. I want this whole catfight business to be abolished. I want that label to be gone. That's what I'm fighting for.
That's very fascinating. And Suzanne and I were talking about this the other day is like, a guy's way typically of dealing with things is like you go fight and punch each other in the face and then you're like best buddies afterwards.
Yeah.
Right. Where females tend to not do that as much and they would, you know, they have some sort of fight or they go silent or something like that. So I guess there are these sort of built-in stereotypes of how these things are treated. But it's really interesting to hear you say that it didn't feel like there's like if you were to say, is it a male dominated industry or a female dominated industry? It sounds like it's fairly even. Is that right?
Well, in terms of domination, in terms of on air, there are, yes, like very strong females in my company. Mm-hmm. But like I said, I'm not sure about what the pay structure is like. That part I'm not aware about. And we had a summit for our company, not last summer because of the pandemic, but the summer before. And the summit was amazing. It was fabulous. And our GM, he asked me my thoughts on it. And I straight up said, do you want me to be honest? If you know me at all, it's my strength and it's my weakness. I like to say what I think. Mm-hmm. And I just really hope that I think before I say it though, so that I'm not coming across as a know-it-all I'm a very opinionated person. And I think that's okay. I think it's okay to be opinionated. It's just how you're saying it, your delivery of things. Right. So I said to him, I go, do you want the truth? And he's like, of course I want the truth. We just put the summit together. And I said, okay. I'm like, I love the idea of the summit. I love the fact that you flew us out to Calgary. You took us out of our norm and took us and put us with a whole bunch of other amazing broadcasters in the industry for us to brainstorm together and watch all these speakers and have all these seminars. I said, but where it was lacking was I really felt that this industry is still a boys' club for the table that I was sat at, because they mixed us all up. They wanted us all to meet new people. And the table that I was sitting at felt like a complete boys' club to me. Mm-hmm. And also the speakers, the main speakers, 95% were male. And I said to him, you know, when the majority of the room was female, but your main speakers and your experts were all chosen as male, that doesn't resonate well for someone like me who is so career focused and has so many goals. And I don't know, I constantly is building and thinking that for me wasn't the proper representation. I would have liked to see some more stronger females for me to look up to, for me to listen to, for me to relate to, and also to have some of that boys club stuff start getting abolished, right?
Yeah, that's something I think about. So are you saying that, this is all personal taste, so this is not a right or wrong answer, but when you think about someone, a speaker or someone that's sort of coming in to inspire you or share a story, do you find, this might be an obvious question, but do you find that you relate more to females right away, or is it sort of male or female, you could, you know, it doesn't matter. Do you feel?
It's not about that. I think it's like at the end of the day, you want to feel represented. And the other thing that I also did mention at that time, like there wasn't anybody of color. Mm. And I'm an ethnic minority. I'm a visible ethnic minority. So for me, it's relatability, right?
Yeah.
You want to see what you're being represented by. And I'm not saying that the speakers had to be all female, but it would have been nice to have more than one.
Yeah. Yeah.
If there was 10 speakers and only 10% are female, I don't think that's the proper representation.
Yeah. That's so
especially
great.
When you're saying that you want to see more females in, you know, bigger roles, managerial roles, and higher positions, then you also have to illustrate that. And dude, my boss, he loved the fact that I was so open. He was so willing to listen and was totally like, thank you so much for that feedback, because he didn't see it that way. Mm-hmm. Right? And to have it being said, and it opened up his eyes, and he was, he was really thankful for my honesty. And like I said, I was careful in how I was presenting it, but it was just some of my thoughts.
Well, it sounds like he has some good emotional intelligence, because that's one of those things that he's probably shocked by after, once you told him, you're like, oh my gosh, I never considered that. Or he, mm-hmm. you know, now you open the door to sort of the minority side of things. I was curious on that, because, you know, your Indian background, and then even that, again, I'm just so curious about this. Even that has kind of changed recently. You know, there's been, you know, is it South Asian that you'd like to be referred to? Is it Indian? How do you think about you know, how do you think about that? And then also the diversity in your workforce. You see a lot of diversity with, you know, race, I guess, in your workforce.
Mm-hmm. I mean, it's happening more and more, but not when I first started. It was a really big deal. And I knew I was, I was probably part of a quota. and that's fine. Like, I started on a multiculturalism station, which means like they had a quota of how much ethnicity needed to be on there and represented.
Is that right? Like that was a legitimate thing?
Oh yeah.
I didn't. Okay.
No, no. So when I first started, I went to SFU and I was always really into drama and acting and all that kind of stuff in high school. And, so when I came to SFU, I was obviously getting my degree because I was reading criminology and business and political science because I was supposed to be a lawyer, but things changed, went sideways. But still, I got I helped with a cultural organization, and we put on this beautiful culture show. And in this culture show, I was acting in a couple of the plays, and I was emceeing the show. And someone from one of the multiculturalism stations, he was a producer and creator, and he asked me if I wanted to be involved in the show that he worked on at that time, on the multiculturalism station. And I said, yeah, I'd love to. And I fit the criteria. I was a woman and a woman of color. So I was checking the boxes, and that was fine with me because I wanted some advantages of what I was like. You already have a hard enough time, you know, facing so much discrimination and racism growing up, that I was like, I had no problem with saying, did I get this job? Probably because of being a woman and being of color, probably, and I'll take it. But bringing up like what we call ourselves now, oh yeah, the scrutiny of, oh my gosh, like there's so many things you can say and so many things you can't say, and the amount of people that get offended with what you say. It's all over the place. There's brown, there's South Asian, there's Indian, there's Indo-Canadian. And then like now the total taboo, which I've learned the hard way, like growing up, I call myself East Indian, but we don't want to say that because that was a complete colonial term that came up, you know, with taking over India and, you know, what happened at that time. But a lot of people have very strong opinions on what to be called. And even the word Indian, I've started now saying it more than ever. I am Indian because I want the power back to be able to say that's what I am, because that is what we are. We came from India. What happened is just, you know, when, you know, the explorers got confused and they thought they were landing in India and they weren't. And that's where the term got misused.
And I love this conversation. Like you mentioned the term brown, but that's not something that anyone can call Indian people.
No, I can say it to myself if I want to.
Yeah, but that's yeah, okay. And the other thing I was thinking about is, you know, all of our holiday traditions and things like that, whether it's Christmas or whatever our sort of Western traditions are. Do you find that you have to advocate for yourself? Like if it's Diwali or something like that, do you have to, like, would your station, and I shouldn't make this about your work. I'm thinking about my own office, you know, do you have to sort of make that happen on your own? Whereas all these other celebrations just kind of happen because they're traditionally Caucasian or white holidays. Mm-hmm. And then like Diwali, is it a big celebration where you see, or is it like, okay, no, we have to make this happen. Like, do you find you're supported that way?
Yeah, totally. And it's been super cool with my work. And I think it does happen because I am Indian. But when it comes to Diwali, Baisakhi, Holi, Lori, anything big, if I bring it up and say, hey, can we make a little mention of this, it's always like, for sure. Or let's make a little splitter that says, happy Diwali. May your homes be filled with love, light, and laughter, you know, this Diwali season. And it's always been... it's been encompassed, and it's been great, and it's been awesome, and it's been so supported. So all that stuff is super cool. And even now at schools are really starting to embrace Diwali and Baisakhi and have more conversations about that kind of stuff at school, and have an understanding that, you know, we do need to be a little bit more like be advocates for other people and their cultures and what's important to them as well.
Yeah. And I remember I was so shocked and almost embarrassed. Years ago, I did a survey of our own people, and it was about a Christmas party, you know, and nowadays Christmas parties, they're called holiday parties because not everyone celebrates Christmas and that. And I still like calling it Christmas because I think I want to celebrate the other celebrations that you have just as much as I want to celebrate Christmas. So the example was, I did this whole survey and, you know, we had Jehovah's Witnesses. We had a whole bunch, we had people that we didn't even realize, you know, celebrate things differently. And almost every religion or background has some sort of celebration. And wouldn't it be great if our organizations could make sure that comes from within the company? It's not like a group of people that only celebrate this have to bring it up. Oh, can I bring in some decorations or can I do this? It's like you said, in the schools, they're celebrating Chinese New Year. They're celebrating Diwali, you know, from kindergarten onwards, which I think is excellent to see.
Mm-hmm. And I think I was one of the advocates for, because our kids go to school together, Graham, and I was the one who's going in before COVID and going in and doing some of the Diwali presentations for the younger kids and explaining to them what Diwali is all about and going in and wearing the Indian outfits and getting the kids to participate and showcasing it and teaching. It also is teaching my kids to be proud, because when I was young, I wanted to hide it, right?
Yeah.
And I was just thinking how fortunate my children are that they're going to a school and they're in this place and time where their school and their classmates are celebrating their culture with them, as opposed to making fun of it, which is what I went through as a child. And I try and tell my kids these stories and their minds are blown. Their minds are blown when they hear some of the stories from my childhood. I'm not saying that the kids I grew up with weren't great. They were great. They just, we didn't know any better, right?
Yeah, it's amazing the change we've seen, but it also seems like we have so much work to do.
Oh God,
There's so much going on around us right now with, you know, Asian hate and things like that. And I'm kind of curious, what's your take on all that? There's black, you know, you've got your own cultural issues. There's Black Lives Matter that's been very prevalent over the last couple of years, and then now the big movement. You know, some really bad stuff happening around Asian, you know, violence and things like that. You know, is your radio station talking about that a lot? Are you thinking about that? Kind of where are you?
Oh, yeah. I mean, I've never been prouder of myself and my coworkers than this past year. It's been very difficult and it's been very hard, some very hard, uncomfortable conversations. And Top 40 is not known for this, but we have made it our goal and our mission that we take one break a show and we use our platform for some form of education for the diversity that is needed in our community, whether it's for the movement, the Black Lives Matter movement, whether it's for the BIPOC community in general, whether it's about Asian hate, whether it's for the LGBTQ2+ community, whether it's about the Indigenous community, our brothers and sisters there, whether it's about the Indian farmers, whether it's whatever it may be, some form of a conversation that we feel we have used our platform for good to be an ally to this movement. Because the movement, we can say it's for the, you know, Black Lives Matter, and it is, but if we're doing it for them, we're doing it for our world. And we have to remember that it's not just for them. Like that's where I don't like saying it's for our Black community, because we're all supposed to be one. And that's what they're also saying. Like, we're different, but don't make us feel different. Mm-hmm. And we need to embrace our differences. And we need to be, I'm a visible minority, but just because I am a visible minority, that doesn't give you the right to treat me differently because I'm a visible minority. But it's okay to know that our skin colors are different. And I think that's where the complication is, right? Because some people are like, well, I don't see color. Well, that's not true. We all see it.
Yeah.
But I understand what people are going through. I understand the confusion. And that's why, like, one of my main focuses is to be, not angry when I want to say something. The angry side doesn't work for me, because when I'm angry about it as a person of color, a visible color, being a visible minority, it doesn't get heard as well. Unfortunately, that's just the way it is. But I'm just saying. But when I say it from a different place of more of, hey, like, that's not okay, or I don't really think you should be saying it like that, I'm trying to be more of a racism interrupter now, as opposed to a anti-racism preacher.
Interesting. You know, you just said something there about that someone saying, I don't see race. I read a great article the other day about that, about saying, you know, saying that you don't see race or don't see, you know, color is basically diminishing the whole thing. It's basically burying it, right? And and that's something that I would have said before, because when I was growing up, I grew up luckily in a household that I can never remember my parents saying anything about any race or any color of any sort of, you know, nothing. Like, I really don't remember that at all. Definitely with my grandparents. Now they're both gone, but my grandparents, you know, they had a certain feeling about different races in the country and things like that. But I grew up in a household where that didn't happen. So for my outlook, I was like, what are these people doing? Like they're just, we're all the same. And then that's causing a problem in itself where we're mm-hmm. saying there is no issue. And mm-hmm. and it's like, no, there is an issue. Mm-hmm. And if you don't address it and talk about it, I think that's the problem. And I guess, you know, this is, could be a whole nother hour or two conversation, but I'm just kind of curious, like, what do you think the root of this is? Like, how do we solve this and make it better other than the, some of the things that we're already doing in schools and teaching early about diversity and a community and things like that? But like, there's just, when I see some of the stuff that's going on in the news, I'm just like, who are these people? Like, you know,
it's
so strange to me. And so, like, what do you think the root is? Is it?
Well, I mean, it's really interesting because not everybody would agree with the conversations, but some people think my conversations with my children are a bit too intense. Because I have some friends who didn't even talk to their children when the George Floyd thing happened and that horrible, devastating, just the video, the news stories, the everything. It's just, they didn't even talk to their children about it. Mm-hmm. They didn't even explain to their kids what's going on. Whereas I actually showed my kids the video mm-hmm. because one night they came downstairs, I was watching the news and I thought they were in bed and I was crying and I was watching, you know, and they came down and I paused the TV and they're like, why is mama crying? Is what they asked my husband, Gary. And Gary said, it's because, you know, mom's watching about George Floyd. And my kids were like, you know, the man who died because of the color of his skin. I'm like, yes. And so I showed them the video. And like I said, I'm not saying that's the right thing to do, but I had to have a conversation with my children to say, because of the color of your skin, you need to be prepared in your life that you will probably be in situations where you will get treated differently and not in a good way. Mm-hmm. And I had to have that conversation with them. And I've had it a few times to explain to them. So what bothers me is there are some friends that I have and they don't want to have these conversations with their children. And these friends are in the non-BIPOC community because they think their kids can't handle it. Mm. But I said, if my children have to handle a conversation from their parents that they will probably be in situations in their life that they will get treated poorly because of the color of their skin, you need to have a conversation with your child to make sure they understand that you should not be treating someone poorly because of the color of their skin. Does that make sense?
Yeah. You know, it's so fascinating because I read something after, I think it was both George and the Asian shooting that happened recently. And it was sort of like, there's like posed like six questions. Like, have you ever been sort of looked up and down when you walked into a store? Mm-hmm. You know, have you ever, and it was like, I was like, no, that's never happened to me. You know, have you ever been denied a job because of your name or something? Mm-hmm. And I was like, wow, like these are things that I'm not in touch with because they don't happen to me. Mm-hmm. And so I literally don't know what I'm talking about when it comes to this subject. So I'm always really wanting to learn about what makes this go from bad to better to great, you know?
Sheltering your children from what's happening in the world, I'll tell you right now, is not going to make it better. And that's what is going to cause more problems in the future, right? And that's what I can only say so much. It's not, you know, like I said, I don't want to sit there and be a preacher because it doesn't work. But yeah, I think, you know, and I've also said, like, you know, if I can handle being a victim of racism since the age of 3 and having memories of it, your kids can handle a book about being an anti-racist.
Yeah.
Your kids can handle it. Like for people who want to say, well, my kids don't need that. Like it's too much for them. If I was able to handle, like, you know, other kids throwing rocks at me and calling me dirty and calling me packy when I was 3 years old, your kids can handle a book about kindness and anti-racism and how to be an ally to the community and how to be an upstander, not a bystander.
Yeah, you know, and that's kind of it, isn't it? Like, you're basically what they're saying, and, you know, this is very personal, obviously, to each person, but I mean, basically what people would say is, oh, my kids can't handle it. So you're sheltering them from the truth and from reality. And this reality is out there, so why not educate them? And we did the same thing with our kids. We showed them the George Floyd video, and then another thing, like, there was an article about the trial's happening right now, right? And so I'm watching some of it on YouTube. They do a great job of, they post the entire thing, like 7 hours of video footage on YouTube every day. And The Onion, which is total satire, I want to be very clear on that. I know that it's satire. I know it's not real news, but they did a little post on the trial because it's so absurd that this is like, the whole thing's on video. Yeah. It's like there's nothing to talk about here, but it's gotten so sort of crazy that they're questioning, like, okay, this wasn't a problem. And so it's just a mind-blowing thing. And I think not sheltering people is the right thing to do. Like, you got to talk about it young and early and have those tough conversations, because sheltering people from the real world is not helping anyone.
And I'm not going to lie, like, I have learned so much in this last year. And there's a, you know, the BIPOC community, there's a reason why it's called BIPOC. We all have this,
what does that stand for?
So it's BIPOC. So it's Black, Indigenous, and then people of color.
Okay. And the reason why that's news to me too.
Yeah. And the reason why it's in that order is because it's about the systematic racism. And who suffered the most? So it's our Black brothers and sisters first, because of what happened with them. Mm-hmm. And then the Indigenous peoples and what happened with them. And then people of color. And we had that respect for each other inside this BIPOC label. I have an understanding as a woman, person of color, what I am nowhere near what my Indigenous brothers and sisters went through and what my Black brothers and sisters went through. I have that understanding and I have that level of respect that my stories do not compare to what they have faced, right? So there's a reason why it's in that order. And we have that respect for each other and we have an understanding, but that's not to diminish what someone else's story is, because I do have my own stories of racism, right? And there's still, oh my gosh, I have learned so much with the education that I have given, the time for this year, for the other communities and their struggles and what happened. And I've also learned about myself and where I was scared to stand up for myself in situations, or I laughed off certain things that were not okay. And now I'm learning that it's okay to tell someone, you can't say that.
Yeah. You know,
it's
not okay. And you can stand up and say it, right?
I actually just did it, you know, recently. I was really shocked at how I stood up for myself and my community and let some people know that, did you just actually, no, and then they felt uncomfortable. And that is what I always wanted to avoid growing up. I did not want other people to feel uncomfortable around me, because then I knew that made me feel different. And I didn't like that feeling because I was already different.
Mm-hmm.
And then when I would call people out, it then highlighted the fact that I was different. And that's not what I wanted. So I would laugh a lot of stuff off growing up.
Wow. You know, and I think you said something great there too about not equating it to other people. It's like, you know, there's a saying that I love. It says, like, don't equate your experience with others. It's not the same. It's never the same. It's not about you, but everyone has their own experience, right? Mm-hmm. And so when people can sort of diminish that by saying, because most people think about themselves, right? They don't think about other people. Mm-hmm. And I think as soon as they hear something, well, that's not what I meant. And so you standing up for that, I think, is super important, because, and it shouldn't be controversial. You should be able to say that that's not right. And the person, if they're a friend or whatever, can comprehend that.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Lots of work to do there still. And, you know, another thing I wanted to ask about is, you know, you're very involved in these communities and, you know, supporting communities. And you mentioned that you're doing some fundraising and things like that. Tell me about what's interesting you right now around that.
Yeah, so this was really different because normally I'm the person who will help escalate other people's endeavors. Like I'll be the one interviewing them and saying, okay, what are you working on? What do you need help with? Or I'll help post their stuff on social media or spread the news, or I'm the person who's kind of donating. And I've taken on a challenge for myself. And this is from Options Community Services. They're this amazing organization in the Lower Mainland, and it's their 50th anniversary. And they have put together 50 women, 50 leaders in the community to raise money, to help raise money to put together $1.5 million towards a multi-million dollar affordable housing project in Surrey. Okay, so on King George and 81st, they want to build this amazing housing project. It's going to be 100 units. Mm-hmm. 70 of the 100 are promised to be for affordable housing. So as low as, think of $375 a month. And if you're wondering, well, why would we want this? Well, if you think about refugees who come to this country, who are fleeing these criminal, horrible situations and come to this country with absolutely nothing in their pocket. Or you think about women who are leaving domestic violence situations, again, the middle of the night, nothing to their name, nothing in their pocket. Think of kids who have been through the foster care program and the program, maybe it just didn't work out well for them and they just need someone to believe in them. Those who have suffered mental health issues or addiction issues and finally just getting back up on their feet and just need some help. Mm-hmm. So this affordable housing project that Options Community Services is helping out with is to help build our community into a stronger community. Because when we help people and we give them a chance, there's such a sense of pride to something like that. And imagine if you only have $375 you have to pay for rent, you can actually focus on something. Like I ask my kids, like, what do you think they can now focus their extra money on if they have some? They're like, food. I'm like, exactly, food. Mm-hmm. Food for their children, maybe warm shoes, a jacket. So I am one of the 50 women of Options to help out with this affordable housing project. And my goal is to raise $25,000.
Wow. Congratulations. That's amazing.
Thank you.
And you sound very passionate about it. You totally lit up when you started talking about it. And when is this running for a certain time, or is it open yeah. for a while, or what's happening there?
It's running until June, and Surrey Honda, if you know my relationship with Surrey Honda, I've been, you know, linked with them for many years, and they're so amazing, and the GM Nazir, because I was really apprehensive at the beginning, and I had talked to some friends, and they're like, no, you got to do this. Like, I've never really asked people for money before. Mm-hmm.
It's fun, huh?
And, yeah, it's really hard, and then I realized it's not for me. It's not for me. It's me being able to use my platform to help those in need, to build an amazing community and just help people. And I really feel it's so important to give back. And Surrey Honda is my gold sponsor. So they help give me a wonderful foundation. And I'm just a few thousand dollars away from reaching my 25 grand. So I'm super excited about that. And the community has been absolutely amazing with helping out. And if honestly, every single dollar counts. Every single dollar matters. You get a tax receipt. So if anybody is interested in donating, you don't have to donate to me. It could be to any of the 50 women, but we have a website, womenofoptions.ca, or you can go to my socials at Nira Arora, which is NiraArora. And I have the link set up there. But like I said, even if you just spread the word or spread my link around, but yeah, it's just about, you know, helping other people in the community right now.
That's wonderful. Congratulations. I think, you know, giving is super important. And I also think it's really important to find something that you're passionate about. And, you know, a lot of people are passive givers. So someone will show up at the door and ask for $25 or $50 or whatever. And I think it's great to get a concentration of money towards one source for a bit. And then you can, once you've wrapped that up, you move on to another one where you can have a big impact, and mm-hmm. good for you.
And this was outside my comfort zone. Like, this isn't something that I'm used to, but yeah, it was, there is a feel good element to that, and that's okay. And that is okay.
Yeah. And it should feel, I've heard this before. It should feel a bit selfish because it feels good for you, but it's also helping a community, and that creates such great energy. It creates good energy for yourself. And so it is tough asking for money, but it's so worth it. So
yeah, I was talking to my husband about it, and I was like, oh, I don't know. And he's like, it's a no-brainer. He's like, of course you got to do it. It's a no-brainer. Like, what do you mean it's a no-brainer? Like, yeah, like, you use your platform, do some good with it. I'm like, okay.
Yeah. But, good for you. Yeah. Okay. So, and you kind of topped it off there with, you know, following you, getting a hold of you. It's at Nira Arora. Is it on Instagram mostly that you're active?
Yeah, Instagram, Twitter, Facebook. I think it's all just kind of connected. And yeah, I'm working on getting a website going. That's one of my goals, many goals, yeah, of things that I got to do and get going. But yeah, that's where you can mainly find me. Yeah.
Awesome. Well, you know, I really appreciate this conversation. We went into a bunch of different areas and I learned a lot. I really appreciate it. Always love speaking with you. This is our longest ever one-on-one conversation.
Yeah, I think it is.
I really enjoyed it. So thanks for being here today. I really appreciate it.
Oh yeah, no problem. Thank you so much for having me and, you know, helping to use your platform for, you know, some of the stuff we talked about. Cause yeah, I mean, there's lots of, we're all constantly learning and we're all sometimes right or wrong about things, but at least it's about being open about what you're listening to, right?
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
The Graham Robbins podcast is dedicated to helping you overcome challenges to scale your business successfully. You can learn more at aacb.com. Thanks for listening to the Graham Robbins podcast. We hope you've got at least one key takeaway from this episode that you can implement to start making positive changes in your business today. To learn more about leadership, strategy, culture, and a host of other helpful topics, be sure to subscribe to the show in your favorite podcast player. Thank you so much for listening. See you next time.